Yes, you're seeing Marianne Brandt at the top of the Brandt family's cottage in Storedal, Solia, in 1928. And this was also featured in the catalogue, Bauhaus på Norsk, på Henny Onstad Museum in 2014. And this exhibition did in fact manifest that Bauhaus was more well known in Norway than we generally believed. A lot of Bauhaus and German connections were more or less quieted down after the Second World War. All the things that were German, although Bauhaus was democratic, very few talked about it. The direct connections to Bauhaus has been also very hard to pinpoint, however. But of the recent years, some of these have been revealed. And while preparing this lecture, I've come across some more connections. Let me start with the first connection, going back to 1919. Although here we see what I said, there were definitely some marks of Bauhaus in Norway at the time. And back to 1919, the very year that the Statliche Bauhaus was founded, and to the date, 12th of June 1919, a summer wedding was celebrated at Professor Christian Brandt's villa at Rikshospitalet here in Oslo. His son, the painter Erik Brandt, who we see here, was marrying Marianne Riebe from Chemnitz. And since it was such a nice summer's day, photographs were taken in the garden. Little did the photographer know that the young bride should become one of the most famous designers of modern times. Nevertheless, she died impoverished and in obscurity in a nursing home in Kirchberg, Chemnitz in Germany in 1983 at the age of 90. She was in fact so poor that she could not afford new teeth, a good friend of mine who visited her told me. Paradoxically, just a few years later, in 1989, Marianne's wonderful little tea infuser was sold for 2 million kroner. And today there is an enormous interest in her design work. Relatively few knew that the great love of Marianne Brandt was a Norwegian painter, Erik Brandt, and that she undertook several travels to Norway and partially lived here. They met in Weimar in 1916, where both of their students in the painting department of Das Grossfürstliche Sächsische Hochschule Bildende Kunst. Nesten like so vanskelig som å si Statens Kunst- og Håndverksskole. When Erik graduated in 1919, they decided to go to Norway together and get married here. Their honeymoon was a camping tour to the islands around Risør. They also visited the family chalet in Solia and lived in the Brandt Villa for about a year. I still wonder whom they met here that year in 1920. Could they have met the headmaster of the school, Jacob Prytz, or his protege Hanna Visum? They certainly met the painters Gunnar Scott Rud and Carl von Hanno. I've just been up to Mari Maurstad, who is a relative of Gunnar Scott Rud. She's going through the family archive. And who were Erik's friends? They were both Erik's friends. And perhaps the sculptor Maja Refsum, who in 1921 matriculated in the sculpture department at the Weimar Academy, which in 1919 in fact had become Das Staatliche Bauhaus. Maja Refsum is probably most known for her Amalie Skram sculpture at Nordnes in Bergen, but she also made terracotta panels for the Oslo City Hall and for the Oslo Fjord American liner. She is known to have boasted of the fact. Well, Kirsti Hopstock, her daughter, told me that she boasted of the fact that she had been to the academy wall to wall to Bauhaus. In fact, she was a student of the Staatliche Bauhaus itself, since Gropius in 1919 had merged the various departments into one unit, Das Staatliche Bauhaus. In February 1920, Erik had his debut at the Victoria Kunstsalon in Handelsbygningen in Oslo. He showed mainly graphic works. Extremely expressionistic. Here we see the Bauhaus, the Staatliche Bauhaus, where Maja Refsum went to school, the big building for fine art, and just on the right hand we see design and craft department. So it was in fact wall to wall. And Erik showed this kind of work, extremely expressionistic, depicted the somber war times experiences. The critics says that he was the most somber debut they have ever seen, but clearly also some merry ones here, with perhaps Marianne jumping a wire. Marianne must have accompanied him to support him that on that opening, but the press reception was certainly disappointing. Given the conditions in post-war Germany, the artistic couple had probably wished to remain in Norway, but Marianne found it difficult to accumulate. In the autumn of 1920, they traveled to Paris, and there before moving on to Kongsvinger in the spring. And Erik published an article in Dagbladet on Norwegian art life in Paris. He was very critical of Paris's renommé as a supreme mecca of the arts. During his time in Paris, Erik became inspired by the painters André Derain and André Lhote, adopting a brown-gray ascetic kind of palette, emphasis on the constructive. His friends Gunnar Ruud and Carl von Hanno studied under André Lhote at the time. Another Norwegian in Paris in 1920-21 was also the sculptor Maja Refsum, whom I mentioned, who enrolled in the sculpture department of Bauhaus Weimar in the autumn of 1921 that year, for a year. The Brunts may, in fact, have inspired her, and Marianne herself switched from the fine art to sculpture department that very autumn, so they certainly knew each other. However, in the autumn, here they are in on the way to Paris, probably Erik and Marianne, in the autumn 1923, Marianne saw the first Bauhaus exhibition with George Mucher's epoch-making experimental House am Horn. And after 12 years of study, she destroyed all of her artworks and set off on the path to becoming a designer. She applied for the Bauhaus Design and Crafts Department, where she enrolled in the introductory course in Laszlo Mahalinos in January 1924. Marianne emphasized that there were also practical reasons for this change. She said there was the general perception that two painters thought together couldn't probably support themselves. She joined the metal department in the fall of 1924. Here they are in 21, probably in Weimar. And in 24, she joined the department actually as late as October. So these works were done October, November, December. She was the first woman to join what would later become such an unknown workshop. Walter Gropius, however, had determined that all women should be referred to the weaving department. And Brandt's new schoolmates proclaimed that women don't belong in the metal workshop. She proved them wrong. They put her to do the most difficult thing, to hammer out these rounded pieces, and she did it better than the men. We shall not dwell with Marianne's production, which is well known to you, but perhaps see much look more at the relation with Erik and their travels in Norway. Here from the metal department, we see here Marianne on the left in the back, but otherwise only men, as you can see, and Laszlo Mahogany Nash in the middle. Erik travels had and they had a lot of contacts in Norway at the time. Bauhaus Dessau was not finished until late 1926, so Erik returned home to Norway for a while in 25-26, exhibiting at Blomqvist's Art Gallery in April 1926, and then he went to Paris to join Marianne for about a year. She enrolled at Bauhaus in 1927. You see her student pass here, but Erik stayed on in Paris until spring 28 when he returned to Oslo for another show at Blomqvist's. And the critic Jaffa Nielsen's finally wrote positively, saying that it was a jump into a new time. During the Paris days, Marianne made her first photo text collages. The first two were Bulle, Esel Affel, and Kan der Mensch ein Sieg schaffen. These early photograph text collages can be read like a diary, and she uses French, English, German, and Norwegian sentences and words that allude to their complicated relationship. The first photo text collage from 1926 is double-sided, and the title Bully, Esel, Affel refers to the nicknames they call each other. Erik's jealousy, especially on Maholinage, is referred to with the words L'amant de sa femme. A photo showing Erik and Marianne's sister Susanna in his studio in Paris points to the menage a trois relationship they possibly had. The other side of Bulle Esel has been called the idole moderne. It depicts first and foremost the handsome Erik. She said it was a mistake to get in love with such a handsome man. And among scantily clad women, a reference perhaps to his infidelity, with textures such as Sa femme, Die Nächtlichen, La Norvège intéresse aussi les femmes. The composition has certain similarities with Märzbilder by Kurt Switcher, whom Marianne was a good friend of, and she may in fact have told him about her travels to Norway when he decided to move here in 1937. Kom der Mensch ein Schicksal also builds on the personal. Marianne's head is placed in the center, surrounded by photos of Erik and her sister Susanna, as well as a text suggesting a possible menage à trois. Brandt made approximately 50 montages and collages during these years, 26, 31, and about 30 are preserved. When Gropius and Maholinage left the Bauhaus in the spring of 28, Marianne, in fact, wanted to join them, but they convinced her to take over as acting director of the metal workshop. And by the summer of 99, however, the metal workshop was merged with some of the other studios. A lot of merging in those days as well. Brandt therefore decided to leave the school, and she received, as soon as she received her diploma in September 1929. Late in 29, Marianne was employed in the drafting room of Walter Gropius in Berlin. She moved to Berlin. Here she worked with furnishings and the housing development in Karlsruhe-Darmstadt, and in 1930 she showed her works at the Deutsche Werkbund exhibition in Paris. From December 29 to 30, she worked as an employee, as a designer for the Ruppelwerk metalwork factory in Gotha, where she revitalized the entire design repertory. We have a few of these objects that we have bought over the last years. In early 32, the Bauhaus relocated again, this time in Berlin. But only a year later, in April 1933, the school was closed by the Nazi regime, and every tutor at the school was classified as degenerate. Marianne was now out of work, and she made plans to travel to Norway in order to leave Germany. This would have been had a fantastic consequence for Norwegian design. Just think about that. Her relationship with Erik had stagnated, however, and her parents were becoming frail, so she decided to move back to them in Chemnitz. She remained there until 1949, but her artistic development was drastically curtailed. In 1934, Erik wanted a divorce. Marianne mentioned his miserable financial situation, and now that she had no income, he wanted to leave her. She did not want a divorce, but as she said, one cannot keep that which will not stay. The following year, Erik married Gunvor Arthur, and by this time he had become known as a fierce critic of the Henrik Sørensen group's dominance and backwardness, as he called it. He was a bit of a querulant, they used to say, and he was chairman of Unge Kunstneres Samfund, member of the board of Bildende Kunstneres Styre, 33 to 36, and a member of Nasjonalgalleriets Acquisition Committee, as well as Kunstneres Hus advisory board. But he never had any great success as a painter. Marianne remained unmarried, however, but kept in contact with the Brandt family, evidenced by letters found among her personal effects, a lot of them in Norwegian, so she probably read quite well Norwegian. Among her papers were also several photographs from Norway, from the family cottage in Solia in Storelvdal. And some letters, and here we see also Marianne sitting in front of the fireplace and probably with one of her own bowls behind there. And the chessboard, which was so important in the Bauhaus, also in the education. But some letters have been preserved also with drawings in the letters by Erik. Here you see her resting on his studio bed. And they are, in fact, this is in fact from his studio in Neubergarten 6B. I think it was also there that Eikos had his studio at the top. The photo and the drawings have been misdated in Bauhaus archive as 1920. But Erik did not actually advertise for a studio until 1929. I found that advertising. And previously, this studio belonged to Thomas Schwarz. He was a advertising man. The drawings were probably sent prior to Marianne's visit in 1930, when Erik had a major exhibition at Blomqvist. One is inscribed Mein lieber Affe, a nickname he gave her. In this typical artist studio, there is an interesting kettle on the hot plate, which could be one of Marianne's kettles from 1924, the same one that, in fact, Tor Kielland illustrated in his 1932 book about Tostrup 2 years later. It is quite possible that this was given to Erik, and it must have made an impact on certain visitors. In a photo montage by Erik from the summer of 1929, we see several of the paintings he was working on that year. And three of these are shown in a photo featuring him and Marianne at Blomqvist's in 1930. Jappe Nielsen wrote in Dagblad that he could finally trace a good development in Erik's paintings, and that they were mainly still lifes, but also a self-portrait and a portrait of an almost improper obese lady, as he said. And here you see the lady in between the two. She's really there. It must be about Madonna with the big boobies or something like that. Here we see Erik and Marianne flanking this portrait. And the charismatic and highly successful Marianne must have captivated Norwegians. He looks rather hollow-cheeked, but she looks strong. And unfortunately, we do not know whom they encountered, but most certainly the other exhibitors, Gustav of Geierstam, Johan Fredrik Veding, and Alfred Hammerbeck. And she may also have met Maya Refsum, and certainly some of Erik's friends, Gunnar Scott Rud, Carl von Hanno, and by this time also Torbjørn Lie Jørgensen. It was these three artists who organized a memorial exhibition for Erik when he died just 50 years old in 1947. Torbjørn Lie Jørgensen, also called Gulljørgen på skolen and in the school, is the most interesting in this regard. He loved gold. He was also a goldsmith, educated at Statens Kunsthåndverksskole under Jakob Prytz from 22 to 27. And during the period 27-61, he was employed as a designer for David Andersen. And he was responsible for several of the firm's most outstanding designs. Some of these are clearly Bauhaus inspired, and it is quite likely that Lie Jørgensen met Marianne Brandt during one of her visits to Norway. For there was a change in his work precisely at this time from a more neoclassical to the more functionalistic. In the spring of 1929, he showed some of these objects in the major exhibition Norsk Guldsmedkunst at the National Museum in Stockholm. Swedish critics described them as something radically new, and that they were references to certain German trends. In the autumn of 29, David Andersen provided Lie Jørgensen with a traveling grant for a year's study in Germany and France. He went to Paris and Berlin, and he may well have visited Marianne Brandt, who worked for Walter Gropius in Berlin then, and perhaps also his friend and contemporary from the school, Wilhelm Bjerke Petersen in Bauhaus Dessau, written about here. In any event, he was certainly familiar with the Bauhaus aesthetics at this time, which was well established in Germany and also gradually in Scandinavia. Upon his return, Lie Jørgensen said in 1931, we have happily embraced the program of Neue Sachlichkeit because it has reintroduced some of the most fundamental requirements of linear and formal harmony and compositional balance. In 1934, Lee Jørgensen made an astonishingly radical design, one of the most original of this time in Norway. A cocoa jug in silver for David Andersen, consisting of two simple basic forms, an oval body with a cut-off conical spout, which was exhibited at the International Exhibition in Brussels in 1935 and in Paris in 1937. Mariante Brandt had also worked with similar constellation of shapes and what she described as the eccentric oval. Lee Jørgensen may have been familiar with this, since many of his subsequent avant-garde designs for David Andersen are evocative of Marianne Brandt's forms. Marianne may also have encouraged another Bauhaus female student to travel to Norway. For I have just discovered that in the summer of 1929, the Austrian-Hungarian-born weaver and textile artist Otti Berger visited museums in Oslo and Bergen to study all Norwegian textiles. Berger was educated at Zagreb. Here you see her in Lucia Moholy's marvelous photographs with the Bauhaus balconies, the famous Bauhaus balconies. She was educated in Zagreb, Kunstgewerbeschule, and she matriculated at Bauhaus in January 27. She took the preliminary courses under Moholy Nagy and Vasily Kandinsky, and in October 27 she began weaving under Gunta Stölzel, who had recently taken over the workshop. And she accentuated prototypes for the industry rather than the individual artistic expression. You see Gunta Stölzel standing there in the back. Just in front of her is Otti Berger, and between her legs, Annie Albers. And on the very right, Gertrude Dirks. And she also encouraged the students, Gunta Stölzel, to go abroad for a semester. Good for everyone, as you know. And in May 29, Berger, together with her fellow student, Gertrude Dirks here on the very right, joined a 6-month course at Praktiska Vevnadsskolan in Stockholm, founded by the legendary Johanna Brunsson in Dalsland in 1873. As the first of its kind in Scandinavia, and from 1920 run by her niece Alma Jacobsen until closure in 1958. The school was particularly famous for exploring various challenging weaving techniques. While the patterns often were taken from historical textiles in Nordiska museet and other museums. Two of the major Swedish textile artists were also tutors there at the time Otti joined the school, Hildegard Dinklau, who was responsible for the school's designs for the Stockholm exhibition, which you see here, quite some marvelous things, and Barbro Nilsson, later director of Märta Mås Fetterström's workshop. Nilsson conducted summer courses in plant dyeing, and it was probably one of these that Otti and Gertrude attended. Berger also gave some lectures about Bauhaus while staying in Stockholm, and there are some references to an exhibition at Nordiska Kompaniet, NK, where she may have shown some of her fabrics. She certainly made an impact in Sweden, for in 1930, her article Stoffe in Raum was published in the Swedish magazine Form as Tyg I Rum, with several illustrations, including her grand piano drapery in silk and synthetic silk with bleached and unbleached yarn of different strength and texture. And her famous känselskala, som det blir sagt på svensk, the tactile board, developed in Moholy Nagy's preparatory class in 1927, a sort of material alphabet that you could read from left to right with your fingertips, to feel the different kind of yarns and inserted paper colors. This important article was published almost simultaneously in the Bauhaus special edition of the magazine Red. And Otto cleverly debated the transformed modern functions of fabrics and defined their role in architecture and home decoration. She saw the meaning of textiles in practical functional use. The fabric becomes expression, she said. Why then do we need flowers, climbing plants, ornaments? The fabric itself lives, said Otte. In July 1929, Otte Berge made a study trip to Norway from Stockholm. She was interviewed by Bergens Tidende the 18th of July 1929 in Bergens Museum's textile department, where she had studies for three days. She explained that she was unsatisfied with what she had seen in Stockholm, very good for us Norwegians, and that she was completely infatuated with the textiles she had seen in Oslo and Bergen. Apparently, Berger was quite astonished, and she mentioned the weavings from Sogn and Hardanger as utterly beautiful, woven precisely as the technique demanded. The stylization is very good and the coloring exquisite, she says. These works are exemplary and you should continue working in this way. Yes, listen to that. She also emphasized that the main characteristic of these carpets was the completely flatness of pattern without any illusory depth, which unfortunately was frequent and used in many other countries. The small square patterns are delightful and the use of handspun will bring about an artful effect, she says, as well as the planted colors, which are wonderful. A letter from Otte Berger to the director of the Museum of Decorative Art in Bergen, written with no capital letters, very hard to write actually, confirms that she visited the museum and her name is also listed among the museum library visitors that summer. She probably traveled to Bergen to see the comprehensive West Norwegian weaving art exhibition at the museum that summer, which mainly contained older samples of textile art. Some of these lauded examples certainly influenced Berger's subsequent weaving experiments. Here you see her own nursery carpet, which she did just after she returned home from Scandinavia. And you see one of my orchids here next to it. And particularly the back of the orchid looks very similar to her weaving, in fact. Berger also revealed that another reason for visiting Bergen was to see her old maternal grandfather, whom she had never met, Max Krausz, a Hungarian Jew who had been a personal disciple of Karl Marx and had emigrated to Bergen in 1879, soon to become a pioneer in the social democratic movement in Norway and a typographer and a part-time editor of newspaper Arbeidet. Have you heard about that one? From 1893 to 1931. Otte's mother, Ida Krausz, was probably of an earlier marriage, born and raised in Hungary before Max's departure. They traveled around a lot, these social democratic pioneers. Max married, probably in Sweden, a Swedish lady, and had several children in Bergen. His son, Bjarne Krausz, Otte's uncle, established Wallin's book printers in Oslo in 1930. And his daughter again, Åsta Krausz, became a well-known song pedagogue and lived until the 1990s. In Oslo, Berger visited Henrik Grevenor, the chief curator of the Oslo Museum of Decorative Art, who himself, as Øyvind just told me, was married to the dancer in Jacobi of Jewish origin as well. And he was introduced to the museum's famous weaving collection there. With Grevenor, comprising the Balisol tapestry from the 12th century. But it was the more geometrical-like patterns like this one that she was interested in. The subtle color combinations that mostly interested her and subsequently inspired her designs. She ordered 5 photographs. It was the only written image we could come up with. Was a receipt. We sent out 5 photographs to her from the museum. So proved that she brought some of this with her to back to Dessau. And in the years following a trip to Norway and Sweden, she experimented with these simple and elegant geometrical patterns, particularly rya and rag rug weavings. And thus we can confirm a specific Norwegian influence in Bauhaus at the time. In November 1929, returning to Stockholm, Otte Berger became an employee of the weaving workshop at Bauhaus. Together with Annie Albers, she stood in for Gunther Sturzel, who had given birth in October, and alongside developing new fabrics, Otte had to ensure the production of new fabrics designs by herself for the industrial production, among them 120 bed covers in synthetic silk. Otte was known as an eminent weaver, and she became famous for her various loom systems and innovations in the training workshop. Her design often took place directly at the loom. She was very much in favor of that, without any drawings or patterns to follow. The technical experimental works were one side of the study program, and these were complemented by Paul Klee's form classes. He was the form master, where Otte created many sketches and color studies. Klee's emphasis on the chessboard pattern certainly influenced one of her first designs, the furniture textile Carré, also reproduced by Cassina and still able to be bought, I think. Otte Berger's fabrics complied with Klee's and Kandinsky's call for economy of resources and restriction of few design elements, which Otte also observed in Norwegian textiles she had seen. And Klee's exercises with color gradients and color mixes, the harmony between various components to form a composition, which he called polyphony, was implemented by Berger in several of her works. This free artistic training evidently contributed to the reduction of outdated ways of seeing and addressing all the senses, even more important for Otte, as an illness had left her almost deaf. For her, Maholina's idea of material sensibility and the emphasis on touch was vital, and it resulted in her tactile chart, which you have seen. Otte herself often quoted Klee, as she wrote in 1930, "Intuition is a good thing, because one has to eavesdrop on the fabric's secrets. Feel the sounds of the materials. One must grasp the structure, not only in the brain, but one has to feel it with the subconscious," she said. The change from individual hand weaving to what is called textile design today was successfully carried out in Dessau. They had weaving machines that also could be used in the industry, and the debate on structure, texture, and functionality was in focus. And conventional materials such as viscose, cellulose, rayon, cellophane, bast, and paper yarns were used. There were two workshops, one for weaving and another for more industrial experiments. Annie Albers and Otte Berger were among the students who represented the industrial designer's type early on and became successful as designers for the industry. Otte was in fact the first Bauhaus student to patent some of her designs in retrospect, and she was allowed to mark her textiles with a design label. "You have Coco Chanel textiles," she said, "and you also have Otte Berger textiles. Both deserves a label." Gunther Stölzer confirmed Otte's capabilities in a letter. "Her work was always very intense and belongs among the best which the department ever produced." Otte Berger received her Bauhaus diploma in November 30 and was then employed as a designer by various factories in Eastern Germany, producing designs for curtains, bedspreads, and tablecloths. She was also a member of the Bauhaus jury, which chose the fabrics to be produced industrially. One of them was subsequently called Otte Berger Stoff in 1932. When Stölzer resigned in September 1931, Berger was asked to take over as preliminary leader of the weaving workshop, of which the new director, Miss van der Rohe's partner Lily Reich, soon became the head. In January 1932, a joint textile effort was named Reich-Berger, and the published books of samples show fabrics of elegance and beauty. Following the dissolution of Bauhaus, Otte Berger purchased looms and materials and set up her own studio in Fasanenstrasse in Berlin in September 1932. She viewed it as a sort of laboratory in which she developed fabrics for architects and textile companies, as well as more individual material mixes, and three of these she patented. In 1933, she collaborated with the architect Hans Scheron on his villa for factory owner Fritz Schminke. Otte delivered avant-garde textiles for the furniture, bedspreads, curtains, and entire interior, emphasizing the importance of structure and the play of light and shade in the textiles. From 33 to 35, she delivered numerous designs, the so-called Otte Berger Stoffe, to the art historian Siegfried Didion's company, Von Bedarf, in Zurich. They delivered to all leading architects and designers in Europe. And Otte Berger Stoffe were also used, for instance, on Alvar Aalto furniture in May 1934. Here you see the fabulous furniture textile, washable as it says, Otte Berger Stoffe. It's advertised in the newspapers. Otte also got a contract with a Dutch company, the Ploeg, 1935 to 37. Their Dekostof collection was made for the so-called New Bone in Holland at the time, and Otte produced numerous durable, elastic, and innovative textiles in mix of rayon and cotton. Her numerous designs by then certainly made an important impact in Europe. Between 1932 and 37, her inventions and avant-garde designs were featured in several international magazines. And she also published some articles herself, such as Rätta stoffer på rätt plats in the Swedish magazine Spectrum, Arkitekter och Samhälle in 1933. The Bauhaus student Ivo Panaghi published an article Tessuto in Domus in 1935, which Otte Berger, in retrospect, informed was a dictation from her. Be careful. This was the same year as he visited his Bauhaus student friend Ola Mørk Sandvik in Norway in 1935. In 1939, Panaghi married a Norwegian lady and settled here in 1943, and eventually writing the first major article about Bauhaus in Kunst und Kultur in 1968 to celebrate the 50th. Jubilee, but no mention of Otte. Only male designers were mentioned. Otte Berger's situation became increasingly difficult following the Nazi seizure for power. As a Jew declared non-Aryan foreigner, she was obliged to apply for residency every year. This also implied professional disqualification, and so her financial situation became problematic. In February 1937, on Walter Gropius's suggestion, she made contact with the English textile industry and she emigrated to England in September. Unfortunately, she could not speak English and her hearing problem made it no less difficult. It was not until 38 that she got a 5-week job with the Bolton-based company Helios, which produced three of her designs. Her fiancé, the architect Ludwig Hilbersheimer, a friend since Dessau, wrote letters to her, and as he fled to the USA via England in 38, they managed to meet in London. They had planned a new life at the new Bauhaus in Chicago. Otte's Norwegian aunts, Hildur and Marie Krausch, had also emigrated to Chicago, and they would have been a nice support for her. However, Hilbersheim recounts that Otte, before she emigrated, was determined to visit her mother, who was seriously ill in Yugoslavia. 1 year later, her mother recovered, but they could not get a visa for America. After that, there was almost no further sign of life, but Hilbesheim claimed that she was sent to Auschwitz in April 1944. As late as December 2005, information from Russia was published in a newspaper in Israel, along details about her family, her location during the war's years, and then her place of death in Auschwitz, and the death date, 27th of April, 1944. End of a wonderful artistic life. In the Bauhaus in Norwegian, the catalogue, Lars Fonbury mentioned two painters as important for the dissemination of Bauhaus ideas in Norway. Rolf Nösch, a German who worked in Berlin and Hamburg and met Walter Gropius in 1926 before he emigrated to Norway in 1933, and the Danish-born Wilhelm Bjerke Petersen, who was educated under Axel Revold in Oslo before he enrolled at Bauhaus in the autumn of 1930. His obituary by Sverre Emundsen in Arbeiderbladet, 21st of September 1957, mentions some important information. It says, when the first Norwegian painters traveled to Berlin to visit the Bauhaus school around 1930, they would also have found Bjerke Petersen there. Yes, they would. The writer is wrong about Berlin, however. It was still in Dessau in January 1930, until 1932. But he may have been thinking of Torbjørn Lie Jørgensen, who was a fellow student of Bjerke Petersen, and whom we have already mentioned, and Finn Nielsen, a young painter from Kristiansand, who in 1932 was giving a traveling grant to Berlin and Paris. The 8th of November 1932, he published one of the few whole-page articles about Bauhaus in the Norwegian press, in Dagbladet, entitled Bauhaus in Dessau. His introduction is very positive, glass, steel, and concrete, that is Bauhaus. But he sadly admits that he arrived just as Bauhaus was to be closed, and that he damned the Nazis who had closed the school. It was to be torn down as a symbol of the fact that a new Reich is coming. But luckily, it wasn't torn down. Many people have a certain idea of what Bauhaus is about, he says, but few have realized the enormous importance it had for everything that we call modern, in architecture, interiors, furniture, photography, advertising. Nielsen continues, I am sitting in front of Mies van der Rohe in his office in Bauhaus, a sturdy man at the age of 46. He looks just as stern and sachlich as his surroundings. No fuss here. Nielsen asks, what are you doing now that you have to leave? We go private, Mies said, and we hire an old factory in Berlin. Mies shoved him around to all the departments. The weaving and textile studio shoved the students' exhibition, probably the last one, and perhaps were some of Waterberg's things there. The metalwork department was jolly, he said, with all the fancy machines. Here they make models for the German steel rod furniture, lamps, etc. And if you happen to have a modern reading lamp, you can be sure that it was drawn and tried out as a model in Bauhaus, Finn Nielsen said. I have gone through the whole of Bauhaus and seen all the wonderful, inspiring, and clean working spaces with air and light. And I damn the Nazis who put their noses into this. And I damn them still as I'm sitting on a local train. And some middle-class people who voted for Hitler in the last election says, now you see the glass house for the last time. We shall tear it all down. And a bad-tempered lady says, das Bauhaus ist Volksfremd, Jüdisch, basta. Thank you.